How you doing? It's Tarzan Dan. Very rarely do I get a chance to hang out with these guys on a regular basis, but one of the Backstreet Boys, it's Howie DeRoe.
Hey, what's up, buddy?
It's so good to see you. After all these years, we have known each other since the very, very beginning.
Oh, yeah.
We've known, since the beginning of our career. It's your Tarzan Dan, wherever you're at. Even after all these years, we still love it.
I'm going to tell you how far close to the beginning. It was me in Florida. I'm at the studio at a dance rehearsal, if I recall.
Okay.
And everybody had just got their first check. Nick had bought a pickup truck. Kevin had bought a 4x4. AJ had bought a really crappy BMW. And then I'm like, wow, these guys got really nice cars. And then there's this guy. What was the car that you drove into that literally the only thing holding it together were the screws that held the stereo into the dashboard?
Oh, my gosh. That must have probably been, I had a... It was either my mom's hand-me-down Mazda 626, or I had a Nissan. It was definitely nothing special.
It was a special rust color. That's
yes,
what it was
a rescue.
Yeah. Hanging out with the back hair boys. Okay, the Backstreet Boys, and you can just call me Baldy Lux, like they always do anyway.
There you go.
And what's with this? I shaved my head to be like Tarzan Dan.
I did. Oh, well, okay.
It's great to see you. I'm so happy for everything that's happened over all these years. We've kept our friendship, and I think that's the wonderful thing about this band.
Absolutely.
You guys have always been amazing to me and always treated me well, and I can't say thank you enough. So
thank you.
Finally
thank
in you person, man. You know, even though we see each other, you know, whether it's in Vegas or wherever, we always connect over tour, and I'm so happy for you.
Thanks, man. It's always great seeing you. Always great catching up.
You have a solo project as well, and I want to know a little bit about it because it's a family album. It's not a Backstreet Boys album. Backstreet Boys have DNA out, which, by the way, I don't know if you know, but the album was supposed to be called Dan, but they spelled it wrong. It's DNA.
So it has dyslexia. I don't think it was AJ.
Probably AJ. Anyway, just so you know, DNA is supposed to be called Dan.
Dan. Okay. We'll work on correcting that. Sorry about that.
One of the things that I did want to ask was, you didn't bring up the fact that you would give your son advice in a boy band to not nair his chest.
What are you talking about?
Now the good stuff
what
comes
in. What are you talking
in.
About?
Nothing at all.
Quit playing games with my heart.
Okay, so here's the story. Quit playing games with my heart. He couldn't. Everybody else had their shirt open in the video, and it was raining, and it was pouring down on him. And what had happened to Howie?
I don't know. I think, from what I remember, nobody would take their shirt except for me and AJ, because everybody was scared they didn't have any little ab riblets there.
Okay.
And I think me and AJ were the only two at the time that actually had a couple of, I wouldn't say a six-pack, maybe like a two-pack or something like that there.
But I think that prior to the video or something like that, along those lines, or maybe it was a tour. Maybe I'm crossing my stories, but you had nared your chest because that was a thing you did so you could be smooth.
You know what? I am Latin. I will admit I've got a lot of hair all over my whole body. And at the time, it was not the most thing to be seen as a hairy chest, teenager. So, yes, I will kind of admit that I kind of manscaped a little bit that stuff down.
And then he burned himself, left it on too long.
I think I might have had maybe one of those experiences there, too. I don't remember, but you got a good memory.
Yeah, no, I have.
Did you try it, too? Is that what's going on?
Yeah, pretty much.
Tried it.
I wanted to be Howie. The new album is called...
Which One Am I?
So is that a reference back to Backstreet Boys? Like, which one are you?
It's kind of my homage to the guys. Actually, the majority of this record is family influenced from my kids, but there is one song that's actually influenced by the guys, and it was a funny. I wanted to have fun with this record and just be lighthearted about a lot of subjects that I grew up as a little kid and just had to dealing with that we felt were very relevant. But one of the things that I still deal with to this date is that when we're off on our time off, you know, I'm not walking around, you know, town with the Backstreet Boys, you know, sign all over me. So people don't always recognize that I'm a Backstreet Boy, let alone know even who's in the group of the Backstreet Boys. So I did a little funny spoof on explaining which one of each of the guys are and who Howie D is.
Oh, awesome. So
that's the title track is Which One Am I?
No, you did a great video that I love, and we're going to play a clip of it as well. Is No Hablo Español. You got to tell the story behind it. I know your son's in the video, and he's so cute, and it's very funny because he just suits the part, and he does look like a mini you, doesn't he?
He's my little mini me. I love him so much. He's out on the road here. He's a little ham. He's actually a little entertainer of his own. He's following Daddy's footsteps. He's got the bug. He's got a YouTube channel out there called James the Great, which he's constantly showing backstage footage of our concerts. You've probably seen my house all over the channel, everything. But he, believe it or not, along with my younger son, Holden, they were, like I say, a big reason why I made this record. To give you a little backstory, about 5 years ago, when I was trying to connect with my son, James, he's now 10, but at the time he was 5, I was trying to connect with him out there with the music that was out there. And I had a really hard time connecting with the stuff that was out there. I just really didn't feel entertained. I just couldn't, you know, keep myself focused on wanting just to have, you know, fun daddy-son time. And I didn't understand why. I mean, there's so many great movies that they've, you know, had, you know, success with that have made that connection with, you know, parents and kids, like, you know, the Toy Stories and the Wreck-It Ralphs and then the Minions, all this great stuff that, you know, both, you know, the parents and the kids can enjoy together. But I didn't feel there was a connection with music. And one day I looked out in an audience, and I saw all these teenagers that have grown up with us, just like we have, and now have families, and bringing their kids to our shows. And I was like, there should be more music besides Backstreet Boys for family and kids to have a bonding experience. So I actually started working with some great writers out of New York, a guy named Tor Haim and a woman named Lisa St. Lou. And we started talking about what we wanted to write about. And as we got to know each other, like, believe it or not, your life story is kind of quite interesting. I'm like, really? I don't think it's that interesting. They're like, yeah, you dealt with a lot of things that, you know, kids are still dealing with nowadays. Everything from being shy to worrying to being height challenged to being my sister's shadow, Pollyanna's shadow. And even the song No Hablo Español, believe it or not, is loosely played around the idea when I was younger, my mother being Hispanic, she married an Irish Scottish American. And it was that generation where a lot of the parents that were coming out from these other countries were trying to, in America, make their kids Americanized, no accents.
Okay.
So as a little kid, I didn't grow up speaking Spanish, nor did I really feel like I had the desire until later on, in many years in life, later. But I would always be, you know, when I would hang around other Latin kids, I'd always be like, hey, they would start speaking in Spanish, and I'd be like, no hablo español, and they're like, what?
I said, what's the problem, man? What I do to you? He said,
vámonos, let's go.
But I don't hablo español.
No hablo español.
No hablo español.
No hablo español.
I don't speak Spanish.
It was definitely a journey for me to find my identity. And so I made a fun song about that I'm, like you said, I'm very proud of my son.
Oh, it's a funny
James
video.
Mom.
Yeah, yeah.
And so it's three generations in that
video.
Are
you serious?
Yeah.
Oh, my God. And so was she, like, telling everybody what to do?
She was constantly telling me what to do.
Yeah, right?
I was telling
Nothing James. Changes, right?
Yeah, it's like it goes a trickle effect.
The one thing that I had to ask, now that you said that James has the bug, knowing what you know now, because I knew you back in the day when you were the kid coming up, and now you're the adult with two kids and a wonderful wife and all that.
Thank you.
I have to ask, what advice would you give to him if you walked in and went, Dad, I want to be in a boy band, Dad.
Run. No, actually, you know, I would support my son. He actually thinks that's what he needs to do. I think he said he thinks he needs to get a job at the pizza restaurant near the house first, but he's like, you know, as a
we all
kid,
do, right? You know, we all did
pizza,
that.
He's got
did
Italian
you have
in him.
A job like that?
Believe it or not, as a little kid, I did. Besides doing a lot of acting and singing and dancing and doing musical theater, I worked up in New York City at Zara's Bread Basket with my older sister.
Oh my God!
Mopping the floors and cleaning the cookie sheets and everything. But after that, he swears he's like, okay, well, I got to put a band together. You know, make my own group and everything. But it's funny though. Believe it or not, there's between Kevin's two boys and my two boys. We got a good little start on little Backstreet Boys part two.
And then you got Brian's kid who's like opening the DNA shows.
Yeah,
right?
he's 16 years old, doing really well, doing a country record.
And passing guitars, maybe just maybe you will like it.
Just crazy. It's so cool to see that it didn't just end with you guys. and as they say, DNA is the album, right? The DNA is so deep with you guys. Now, you guys actually had your DNA done as well, if I'm not correct, right?
We did. Actually, part of the promotion of making this record, we wanted to, you know, truly find out what our DNA is, to, you know, let people know about that. And believe it or not, actually, we all found a little bit more extra than we thought in each of us. I found out, you know, I have, like, I always knew, I always thought I was Irish, Scottish, American.
Right.
But I found out that there's even more deep roots into Scandinavia, like 30%.
Oh, wow.
That from my dad's side.
Dude, always amazing to see you. Congratulations on the DNA tour with Backstreet Boys.
Thank
also
you.
On your solo project that is just so endearing. And I also understand that there's a good chance it's going to become a musical. Is that what
yes,
I'm hearing too?
Yes, actually, while we were writing the music for it, it inspired us to, believe it or not, make a musical out of it. Because we were, you know, especially with the writers I was working with, we were starting this stuff and it was all on piano. And actually, Lisa St. Louis is a Broadway performer. She
okay.
performed in the producers. And Tora works a lot in Broadway music and stuff like that, besides being a Grammy-nominated children's album producer. So when we were writing it, I think our writing styles plus my musical influence as a little kid, you know, doing musicals, how I got started in the business, it just naturally kind of played itself into a musical about this boy's journey and finding his own identity and finding his place in this world. And his. So we actually wrote a musical. Actually, after we finished the CD, or album, I guess now as you call them, for the next 4 years after we making the album, we focused on making the musical. And did several rewrites on it. I even workshopped it in New York at the New Victory Theater,
wow.
where right now where Harry Potter's at. I was right next door to Samuel Jackson, working on his production that he
crazy.
Has out there in Broadway. But we've just been very blessed. We've got a theater out of Omaha, Nebraska. It's called the Rose Theater. They're the third largest children's theater in the nation, and we're going to be premiering it there. And I'll be performing in it. The last week of January into the first 2 weekends of February of next year.
Amazing.
Yeah.
This is so cool. Now, you came up through that world of musical theater. You've got to have one show that you really wish that you could do. Because there's life beyond Backstreet Boys or mm-hmm. as part of Backstreet Boys. Mm-hmm. I don't think Backstreet Boys is going away
mm-hmm.
anytime
Absolutely.
Soon. I mean,
totally.
Look at DNA. The album came out, number one. The last time you were had a number one album out of the gate was Black and Blue in 2000, right? And I was there for Millennium when Millennium came out, and we were in New York City in that craziness. That was nuts, right?
Wow.
So so this is so exciting for you guys, but you're going to continue doing that. But have you ever thought about, because of you having that musical background, to go and do a show? And is there one like Wicked or something that you really wish you could do?
I mean, actually, how I started as a little kid was in musical theater. I had my older sister, Pollyanna, kind of take me along and following in her shadow. And one of the first musicals I ever did was The Wizard of Oz. And she was an older.
And what were you? Come on.
I was a munchkin.
Ah, yeah. Yes.
She is 11 years older than me. And so at the time I was like 6 or 7. And they were all the older cast, they were looking for them to bring in their younger brothers or sisters if they had any siblings. And so I came in and I actually said, does anybody want to be one of the Lollipop Guild guys? And so I was one of them. So I got bit with a bug at an early age. And so it's always been a passion of mine to want to get back to doing some musical
right.
theater. My bucket list would be great to do. The Jersey Boys is one of my
all-time
favorites. I've had a chance to meet Frankie Valli and see the show.
I interviewed him too. One of the funniest people I've ever met. Like just so
really
funny,
nice guy.
Right? Really I've nice
yeah,
guy. And
yeah.
just by the end, he was like, you and me, we need to go for spaghetti.
Yeah.
You know, me and you, we got to eat together. Because you're
I can totally see him do that.
Yeah, right?
But it's one good thing about the Backstreet Boys. Like you said, we're not going anywhere. I think one of the biggest reasons why we've been able to stay together for so long is that we communicate. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we all express. We're allowed to, speak freely about wanting to do some individual outside projects. I mean, we all know our mothership is the Backstreet Boys, but there is time, in the times that we have off for us to want to spread our wings out a little bit.
Right.
We allow each other to spread our wings and do stuff. And some of the guys have done some acting, some have done some other solo projects,
sure.
whether it's been recording records, charity work. We're just all really supportive of each other. I feel like we all know that the stronger we are individually, the more we bring to the table as a group.
Look at that. So you got Howie Durow from the Backstreet Boys all these years later hanging out with Tarzan Dan, just like cool times. Thank
right,
you
man.
So much,
Hi,
buddy.
Man.
Good to
Thank
see
you.
Thank you.
Always a pleasure, man.
Wait, we're going to do the Lollipop Guild?
Yeah.
The Lollipop Guild.
With this microphone thing.